Carrying a 50,000-pound payload and only radars, chaff, and flare to defend itself, the B-1 is ready.
Medic 05, right back is correct. Contact tower ready for departure. Medic 05, clear for takeoff. Departure frequency will be 239.05.
With its variable geometry wings fully outstretched and the engines flooding with JP-4, the Bone rises off the tarmac in West Texas. Moments after launch, the B-1 takes on nearly 200,000 pounds of fuel from a waiting tanker. With a full fuel load, the B-1 has a range of over 7,000 miles at a cruising altitude of 25,000 feet. Aerial refueling means it can sustain flight for as long as the four-person crew can last in the cockpit. And although the plane is half the length of a football field, its cramped cabin is no larger than four telephone booths.
The personalities fit in the cockpit, regardless of how they are. If you're asking, do they have some kind of a jock mentality, I don't see that, because of the fact that we don't allow that pretty much on the crew, because we are four people coming together as one cohesive unit. So if one person is a little bit different than the others, we'll try to conform them to fit into our little cohesive unit, if you will.
The pilot and co-pilot sit up front. The offensive and defensive systems officers in a separate compartment about 6 feet behind them.
The offensive systems officer, his job is to get the switches configured and get the INS configured and everything so that he can drop bombs the most accurate way he can. On the other hand, the DSO is primarily concerned with threats in the target area. And if you think about it, where are we going to strike? We're not going to go strike somewhere that probably is not defended. So his job is going to be busy, my job is going to be busy, and the pilots have to kind of juggle the two of us because we're kind of separated at the time. I've got to get the bombs on target, but the D's got to defend the aircraft.
The B-1's payload is meant to strike at the very heart of the enemy's war machine. Munitions factories, command centers, bunkers. Targets typically located deep behind enemy lines.
Usually if we go into a target area, the target area is going to be saturated. Not only ground threats, but air-to-air threats. So this is where things start getting a little intense.
This is the warning that an enemy aircraft has been spotted 25 miles away on the defensive system officer's screen. Before the enemy fighter closes in for the kill, the B-1 pilot points the aircraft 20 degrees nose down, puts it in terrain following mode, and lets go of the stick. With its wings swept back, the plane drops from 25,000 feet to 500 in less than a minute.
You're sitting there with your hands by your side watching this airplane hit towards the ground. Then you're just concentrated on that scope. Is this airplane doing what it's supposed to?
The B-1 is doing what it must to survive. Once spotted by the fighter's radar, the unarmed bomber is as good as dead. The crew's best bet is to hide the 400,000-pound jet in the ground clutter below.
You don't have to completely defeat the threat. You just have to momentarily defeat the threat. Buy yourself a couple seconds here and a couple seconds there.
The bomber's greatest defense is its ability to hug the deck and slip beneath enemy radar at near supersonic speed.
We use the terrain to our advantage when we're low. Like if you were water, where would you flow? You know, and you use that terrain to get yourself buried in there as best you can.
Making the B-1 resemble a catfish, the fins on the aircraft's nose help stabilize it at low levels. Flying a few hundred feet off the ground, frequently at night, pilots count on the terrain following radar to keep the plane from hitting the dirt. However critical to survival, radar sensors can also give away the bone's position. Once in the battle area, B-1 crews turn off any unnecessary electronics to reduce its footprint. The plane's unguided iron bombs are little changed from those used by World War II airmen, but the systems used to aim them are. Here, the offensive radar takes over. The Navigator Bombardier uses a radar-generated map to guide the pilots to the target.
Hey, Putting, what kind of is you got to just left and center at about 90?
Because the B-1 travels faster than the human eye can focus a bombsight, the Bombardier relies on a computer to release the bombs at the right place and time.
If I drop this bomb right now, where will it go? And if it says I'm not going to get any closer than right now, then it'll go ahead and release. So the system is constantly updating itself at a very fast rate.
Hitting the bullseye means calculating wind direction, speed, and timing perfectly. Seconds too late or too soon, and their payload can sail hundreds of feet off target. In just 3 seconds, the plane releases 84 bombs in a perfect line.
The shack, 00. Center bomb on the target. Probably 1% of the time, maybe, the shack occurs. I call it luck, but that's what we all want to get. That's what we strive for, and that's what we train for.
But for many B-1 crews, close is good enough.